Dear students, welcome to the third lecture in literary genres, which is entitled An Introduction to Realism. What is realism? Realism is a literary as well as an artistic movement and tendency that appeared among European and American writers and artists in the second half of the 19th century. It came as a reaction to Romanticism, and since our concern here is with literary realism, it is a body of literature that portrays everyday experience as authentic and real as it is. Well, actions and events or even social circumstances are represented in what we call a point of fact rather than in conceptual form, like during the neoclassical literature, or rather than sticking to the psyche or the state of feelings of the writer, as we have seen with Romanticism. Well, in two words, realism is meant to represent reality as it is and try to come up with techniques or literary devices that would make it easy to do so. Literary realism coincided with Victorianism, or what we call the Victorian era in England. And this era corresponded to the period of Queen Victoria's reign, and it was characterized by a class-based society. According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, about 70 to 80% of the population were considered to be members of the working class. And as you know, with the working class, they belong to the lower class with the bad conditions of living, too much hours to work, and very low income. This has given rise to what we call the less fortunate members of society, who suffered poverty and miserable conditions. And these members of the lower class have tried to find a way of representation. And Karl Marx, with his power of analysis, he analyzed capital society and he came up with what we call today Marxism, in which he believed that society is constructed based on the categories of class, and it is meant to reproduce the same classes over time, the upper class and the working class. And of course there is the rise of the middle class, which try to find a social position in this society. So these conditions and this philosophy or political and social and economic movement of Marxism have encouraged the rise of what we call social realism, in which writers try to represent or try to come up with stories or fictional stories that imitate, or these stories reflect this sense of reality. And this is very important. Also, during this time, publishing industry flourished, and it contributed to the rise of realism, and the rise of what we call docudrama, which is a kind of fiction which found its space in literary magazines and newspapers, written by young writers who were hired by great editors such as, for example, the American famous realist William Dean Howells, who worked both as an editor, as a businessman, and as a writer. Another factor that influenced literary realism is what happened in human psychology. Well, advances in this field led to the rise of what we call a preoccupation with creating or coming up with the representing techniques that would capture the inner working of the mind and emotions, or capture the process of emotions as this process captivates individuals. And this or these psychological insights found their space in the category of characterization. And we can name here the American great psychologist William James and his influence on the work of his brother Henry James. And here a concern with understanding human consciousness and finding or creating technique of representing the psychological process of the mind, and the delicate play of emotions became very important. And we can talk here about what we call the overriding concern with characterization. And here we can talk about Henry James, who came up with some techniques like, for example, internal monologues, in order to represent or try to capture these moments as the character thinks or feels, and tries he tried to narrate the story from this inner psychological perspective. Another thing that happened here is characters became complex as human beings, with we can see that the individual is composed of a network of motivations, interests, desires, fears, and even drives, psychological drives. And we can see how these things or these entities interact together to create what we call an inner struggle between desires and fears. And this has appeared due to the advances of that happened in human psychology. So characterization became, as a result of this, became very important, or we can say even more important than plotting and telling the story. Characteristics of realism. Well, we can talk about different types of realism: psychological realism, moral realism, presentational realism, or realism of content. And here I'm borrowing these concepts from the great critic C.S. Lewis and the great professor Dr. Spurgeon. So it depends on which kind of realism you are talking about. But since this is an introduction, we try to make it simple here. So the first characteristic that we can talk about is the one that we received from the influence of journalism on fiction. And here we can talk about reporting. And as you know, that many American realist writers, they were working as editors for literary magazines and newspapers, as well as writing fiction. And here they started to use this technique of journalistic reporting in capturing details of reality, or incorporating realistic content in their stories. And here we can talk about what we call the realism of presentation. I mean, they start to pay, or they paid attention to the way they should present things as they look or as they are in reality, by capturing all the meticulous details of the real world, even if it's simple, not attractive, but what matters for them, it is captivating and it is realistic. This is one thing. Another characteristic is the attempt of creating a realistic plot structure. And here experimentation with plots started by trying to avoid the epic in which great things happened by heroic endeavors, or avoiding the tragic plot structure, and try to imitate or try to come up with a kind of plot that would imitate the model of reality. Sometimes in reality nothing happened. We have kind of simple life, and that's it. So the novel, according to literary realists, should imitate the real pursuit of life and everyday experience. So instead of pure tragedies and epic turning of events and great heroic happenings, we can find a plot in which we have simple things as real as they are. Even the narrative style has changed. So instead of having an omniscient narrator who is aware of every details in the story, like he has or she has the big picture, so we have here in realism what we call a limited narrator, or a limited first or third person narrator, who has just a perspective about reality, and he's or she is not sure about what's going on in reality, and this to capture the uncertainty and ever shifting nature of what we call the real, because reality is not certain, and we are human beings, so we are not aware about everything. And in order to capture this essence, we need to focus on the narrative style here. Another characteristics is the product of what happened in human psychology, and due to the great psychological insights that were discovered and which influenced the characterization of realistic fiction, is the use of what we call internal monologues in order to come up with real characters who would think and feel as human beings. This technique is meant to improve the quality of characterization by creating real characters, but at the same time it influenced or it has a positive impact on plot structure by coming up by what we call a framework narrative, or creating what we call a story inside a story. Sometimes when we get access to the inner working of the mind of particular character, and we start to started to explore what happened in the past, we can have another story of the character that would take us far away from the course of the main story here. Another characteristic that is also considered as the product of human psychology is the death of absolute heroes versus villains, because humans, after all, or characters, after all, they tend to be as, or they tend to appear as human beings who have motives for actions. And no wonder that sometimes some characters would make mistakes or errors out of good intentions, and this is like the subject of what we call moral realism. Sometimes we question our consequences or our behaviors, and we try to trace them back to some motives, and sometimes the motives are not after all bad, and that's would this insight would collapse this myth of good people versus bad people. And this is thanks to the gift or the psychological insights of the second half of the 19th century. The last characteristic that I would mention here is about the setting. And the realistic novels and short stories of the 19th century, they tend to take place in an urban space where it is possible to capture this this kind of struggle or conflict between classes, between the lower class, middle class, and even their concern with poverty in broken cities of the 19th century. And we can talk here about something else, which is about the viewpoints. So the point of view or the viewpoints of the writer can be implied. So when the reader gets access to the psychological spaces of the characters, he can form his own point of view or her point of view due to the details that he can read. So instead of having a stated very clear viewpoints, we can have instead an implied viewpoints. I would like to finish this lecture by picking a very inspiring quote that summarizes the spirit of realism. The first quote is taken from the work of the American writer John Steinbeck, which is entitled East of Eden. He said, "There is more beauty in truth, even if it is a dreadful beauty." The second quote is taken from a work of the father of realism. He is the Norwegian playwright Henrik Ibsen. And this quote is taken from his play A Doll's House. The character Nora said, "And then I found other ways of making money. Last winter, I was lucky enough to get a lot of copying to do. I locked myself in and sat writing every evening till late in the night. Ah, I was tired so often. Dead tired. But still, it was wonderful fun sitting and working like that, earning money. It was almost like being a man." And the last sentence here, it hints at the transformation of women to be as equal as men. And it's like reversing what to be called later by feminist or the waves of feminism, gender roles. And this is like capturing this sense of reality as women started to be a part of the labor force and joined men in this business. The last quote is taken from a postmodernist writer, Don DeLillo, but this definition actually it's about capturing the sense of the real. So he said, "When I work, I'm just translating the world around me in what seems to be straightforward terms. For my readers, this is sometimes a vision that's not familiar, but I'm not trying to manipulate reality. This is just what I see and hear.